climb the gallows steps as the blade falls and have a seat in the electric chair. The gas rises and the rifles roar. The chemicals flow and we descend into a macabre world of dark and deadly inventions. Now, Death Devices on Modern Marvels. Huntsville, Texas. Lethal injection capital of the world. Where more prisoners are legally put to death than in any other American prison. During the 1980s and 90s, Texas became the world's leading executioner.
We certainly, there's no secret that we have the most active death row, the most active death chamber in the country.
Lethal injection is rapidly becoming the preferred method of execution throughout the United States. Critics believe that it is far from painless and that it can take a long time to complete the procedure. Larry Fitzgerald disagrees.
I can tell you how long it takes for the chemicals to work. We executed an inmate by the name of Jonathan Nobles, and he apologized and recited scriptures as his final statement. He told the warden the signal to start the process would be when he started singing, and he sang Silent Night. And when he got to mother and child, he was dead.
After centuries of brutal executions, the quest for the most humane method of ending human life continues. It's been a long, dark journey. Thousands of years ago, as early civilizations developed, conflicts threatened the survival of communities. Chieftains and leaders were called upon to hear grievances and make judgments. Gradually, codes of conduct were drawn up, and along with these early laws came the concept of punishment. In almost all societies, the punishment for the worst crimes was death. The first tools of execution probably included fists, sticks, and stones.
Well, with stoning, it's almost instantaneous. If the community decides that someone is guilty of something, the community usually will take it upon themselves almost immediately, almost in the form of a lynching.
Although stoning was used on both sexes, it was predominantly used on women and people convicted of heresy, sorcery, and witchcraft. Some early cultures believed that criminal behavior was a manifestation of demonic possession, that the evil spirits could be transmitted through personal contact. Stoning became an effective method of killing at a distance, where a mob would continue to hurl stones at the condemned, eventually causing death by trauma. In the Bronze Age, the development of metal began a new chapter in death devices. In military executions, the sword was used to decapitate people found guilty of treason, cowardice, or mutiny. Ancient Rome introduced the practice of execution as public entertainment, where condemned men and women were sentenced to combat animals or gladiators before crowds of spectators. The Romans also introduced crucifixion and the idea of death compounded by prolonged physical suffering. Victims of the cross could take days or even weeks to die.
Crucifixion, a soldier would strap them up, and the community would come by and be able to stone them, stab them, break their bones, and generally it would take quite some time to die. Dehydration or muscle collapse would suffocate them.
Some 300 years after the death of Christ, the Roman Emperor Constantine abolished crucifixion after his conversion to Christianity. Throughout the Middle Ages, the axe became the blade of the medieval criminal courts. and its widespread use created a new position in the state, that of the headsman, the first executioner. But execution by blade was a crude and messy business. There was still a lot that could go wrong.
In medieval times, it was not uncommon for a person being executed to have to bribe the headsman to make sure that his aim was true and his blade was sharp. God help you if you had a headsman who didn't like you, because he might take more than one stroke to do the job.
In the 16th century, during the Holy Inquisition, numerous death and torture devices were developed. Two survived to become official execution methods in Europe. Both were slow, horrible ways to die. Burning at the stake was made famous by the execution of Joan of Arc. Breaking on the wheel became widely used all over Europe, especially in Germany and France. Breaking on the wheel involved binding the nude victim, man or woman, flat or upright on a giant wooden wheel. As the wheel was rotated, several executioners wielding heavy metal clubs and hammers smashed the victim's limbs, joints, and skull. This brutal method would eventually be replaced by a new mechanical device, which was supposed to be quick and painless. Next, the strange story of the guillotine. Stoning is still practiced in six countries: Pakistan, Iran, Afghanistan, the Grenadines, Sudan, and the United Arab Emirates. Death devices will return on Modern Marvels. On a hot August day in 1788, France's high executioner, Charles-Henri Sanson, ascended the scaffold to carry out the execution of a man by breaking on the wheel. The assembled mob of onlookers suddenly rushed the scaffold and freed the condemned man. The scaffold and wheel were smashed and set on fire. When news of the riot reached the palace, King Louis XVI, now sensing the impending revolt, granted the prisoner a full pardon and abolished the wheel throughout France. 3 years later, after the fall of the Bastille, the National Assembly sought a new execution method to be used on all people sentenced to death, regardless of rank or class.
Ever since the time of the French Revolution, people have decided that capital punishment should be the end of life as opposed to infliction of pain.
A committee was formed. At its head was Dr. Antoine Louis, physician to the king and secretary to the Academy of Surgery. Also on the committee was Dr. Joseph Ignace Guillotin, a professor of anatomy at the Facility of Medicine in Paris. Guillotin and the others had been influenced by earlier beheading machines, such as the Scottish Maiden, the Italian Mania, and the Halifax Gibbet.
It was a very crude guillotine of the time. The blade, it was not sharp, it was more just a big metal chunk, and it would knock the head off or crush the neck.
Sketches and plans were submitted. Two major improvements were the result. First was a convex or crescent-shaped blade. The second was the lunette, little moon, a hinged two-part yoke which immobilized the victim's neck.
The guillotine was invented with the notion that the blade would quickly sever the head with absolute assurance, and it was believed at the time that that would end life instantly.
The crescent shape was soon replaced by an angular blade. According to one historian's account, this sloping blade design was the idea of the king himself, Louis XVI. Upon seeing the sketches, the king, an amateur locksmith, well known for his mechanical aptitude, insisted that the shape of the convex blade was all wrong. Grabbing a pen, the king sketched in a triangular blade with a beveled edge. He contended that this blade would cut much cleaner and could accommodate virtually any size neck. These elements were incorporated into the final design. The new machine was tested on cadavers and cattle, and finally deemed ready to be put into service. On April 25th of 1792, the first man to die under its blade was a thief and assassin named Jacques-Nicolas Pelletier. The crowds marveled at the machine's deadly speed and precision. Soon, a steady stream of victims would be hauled up the scaffold to meet the new modern machine. 9 months after the first guillotine execution, the king and his wife, Marie Antoinette, would experience firsthand the effectiveness of the sloping blade design. Ironically, the name of the man who had contributed the least to the design of the machine was the name it would carry throughout history. But it would be long after the French Revolution that the guillotine's bloodiest chapter would be written. In 1933, Hitler celebrated his rise to power with the construction and testing of his first guillotine. So impressed was he by its function that he ordered 20 more constructed and pressed into immediate service. In addition to the millions murdered by gas and machine guns, Nazi records seized after the war testify that between 1933 and 1945, 16,500 people were murdered by Hitler's headsmen. Whereas execution by guillotine during the French Revolution totaled only 2,600. The last public guillotining in France occurred in 1939 with the execution of serial killer Eugène Weidmann. The event was secretly recorded on film. When images from the film were published, the guillotine was moved behind prison walls. The last use of the French guillotine was in 1977. In the early 1980s, all capital punishment was abolished in France. Across the English Channel, a different method of execution had come into its own. It required only a tree and a rope. Gravity did the rest. Although hanging is believed to have originated in Persia nearly 2,500 years ago, it was developed into a craft by English executioners. In 1500, there were 8 hanging offenses in English law. By the end of the 19th century, various acts of Parliament had raised the number to 225. The prisons overflowed as more criminals were sentenced to die. London's original Tyburn Gallows, just outside the city, was a crude single-beam structure. Prisoners were either hauled up manually or left swinging when a ladder or cart was pulled out from under them. As the number of executions increased in the late 1500s, the single beam was replaced by a three-beam structure, which would gain infamy as the Tyburn Triple Tree. The Triple Tree could accommodate as many as 24 prisoners at one time. These public hangings attracted huge crowds. While some Londoners treated these executions as festivals, still others were repulsed and sickened.
In London, when they would hang people at Tyburn, it was not unusual for there to be botched execution where the individual was dropped off the back of a cart and the knot was not in a proper spot, and these individuals dangled and suffocated.
Public opinion began to grow against these gruesome spectacles. The government was called on to find a more efficient method. Change came slowly. Finally, in 1759, the Triple Tree was replaced by the first trap door structure. This ushered in what was known as the New Drop Era.
The British military, which really studied it, looked into the precise weight of the body, which would help calculate the precise drop of the individual.
William Calcraft, the longest-serving English hangman, is credited with the development of the short drop method. When the trap opened, the prisoner fell 8 to 12 inches. Though an improvement over Tyburn, slow strangulation was still the usual result. Soon after, a new hanging technique was introduced, the long drop method. The long drop involved a fall of 6 to 10 feet, sometimes with the addition of weights. A critical knot placement was also determined along the angle of the left jaw, just behind the ear. This method snapped the neck, causing instant unconsciousness. Death by asphyxiation soon followed. The long drop was not without its problems. Too long a drop or too much weight could result in the decapitation of the condemned. Although the English practice of hanging had exported well to America, England's master executioners and their techniques had not. In early America, with its far-flung seats of law, crude lynchings by local sheriffs became prevalent.
And it was unsightly and it was uncivilized, barbaric. So there was an attempt at the same time to do away with the lynchings and then to create a more civilized environment for executions.
As public outcries against hanging grew louder, many cities began to look for an alternative. The story of the machine that would replace the gallows is one of the strangest tales in the history of American invention. Next, the story of Old Sparky, the electric chair. Hanging remains the second most common execution method in the world. In 1999, 139 people were hanged in 11 countries. Death devices will return on Modern Marvels. It is the last of a vanishing breed. Housed deep inside Holman Prison in Atmore, Alabama, it is one of the last electric chairs still available for use in America.
The one in Alabama was called the Big Yellow Mama. Because the electric chair was associated with a criminal element, there was a lot of nicknames that came for it. The one in Florida was called Old Sparky.
The one at Sing Sing was known as Old Sparky as well. There has always been a mystique surrounding the chair, and many of America's most notorious criminals have had the questionable distinction of dying within its framework. From Ted Bundy, to Sacco and Vanzetti, to Bruno Hauptmann, the convicted Lindbergh baby killer, the chair has claimed hundreds of victims. The story of the chair dates back to the late 1800s, when a new form of power was changing the way Americans lived, electricity. It would soon change the way condemned criminals died. By 1885, several human rights groups were calling for an end to hanging. In 1888, the new governor of New York, David B. Hill, had joined the movement to abolish the gallows. After witnessing a particularly gruesome execution of a woman, he instructed his legislature to begin a search for a new, more humane means of putting people to death. A committee was formed. One of its members, Dr. A.P. Southwick, a prominent dentist, had witnessed the accidental electrocution of a man who had touched a terminal on an unshielded electrical generator. The Death Commission, as it was called in the papers, analyzed over 40 procedures and narrowed these down to four. Garrot, a method of strangulation. Guillotine. Injection. And electrocution. The committee sent out a questionnaire to judges, doctors, and scientists, asking them to endorse one of these four methods. One of the respondents who favored electrocution was Thomas Edison.
He was a major personality at the time. Everybody knew him, and the other members of that committee simply went along with his recommendations.
While the members of the commission had been battling over a new method of execution, Edison had been fighting a battle of his own and losing. The battle was called the War of the Currents. Edison had invested his fortune and his reputation in his direct current utility system. He hoped to sell his system to the world.
Thomas Edison was someone who favored direct current. George Westinghouse favored alternating current. In those days, it was unclear which really was going to win out.
Alternating current was cheaper to produce and distribute. But with its higher voltages, it was considered by some to be more dangerous. Edison and his people took every opportunity to try to prove that AC was too dangerous for public use. When Southwick and the Death Commission came along with their electrocution idea, Edison saw an opportunity to sabotage Westinghouse and AC by recommending alternating current be used for the new execution device. Harold Brown, a close Edison confidant, demonstrated to the committee how AC current could instantly kill animals. The commission was suitably impressed. In 1888, when hanging was replaced by electrocution, Brown was awarded the contract to build the first electrocution machine. He worked closely with a dentist, Dr. Southwick, who would later be called the father of electrocution.
Alfred Southwick was a dentist from Buffalo, and that's the reason that it became a chair. I think it would have become like a table or a cabinet or something like that, but it was a chair because he was a dentist, and he was used to working with chairs.
After several trial prototypes, Brown's final design was assembled by convict labor at Auburn Prison. The chair is a simple wooden fixture that holds the prisoner in place. Once the power is turned on, wet sponges conduct the current from the electrodes into the prisoner's body. The brain shorts out, and the heart stops.
Westinghouse didn't want to use his generator, so he actually refused to sell New York State a generator. So New York State then had to buy a Westinghouse generator from Rio de Janeiro in Brazil and bring it to Auburn Prison.
On August 6, 1890, an alcoholic peddler named William Kemmler, who was convicted of killing his girlfriend, was the first person to die in the electric chair. After the first jolt of 17 seconds, Kemmler was still breathing. A second jolt of 30 seconds finally did the job. When it was over, the chamber was filled with the smell of burnt flesh. Kemmler's head was smoking. He never moved or breathed again. The triumph of modern civilization had come at last. Newspapers around the world condemned the execution. George Westinghouse remarked, "They could have done a better job with an axe." Nevertheless, the chair was here to stay. Even though the technology was improved with higher voltages and better connections, the botches and problems continued. By 1906, three other states, Ohio, Massachusetts, and New Jersey, had abolished hanging and replaced it with electrocution. Executions in the chair peaked between the 1920s and 1930s, when a man named Robert Greene Elliott was the chief executioner in New York. One of the controversial executions he performed was that of Ruth Snyder. She had been convicted of the murder of her husband in 1927. The circumstances around Snyder's execution may have influenced public opinion about the chair.
There was a lot of interest in the United States in the 1920s about how the electric chair actually worked, because no one had actually seen it in operation. The idea of actually photographing somebody was a journalistic coup.
The New York Daily News succeeded in getting that picture. The photographer, who was one of the witnesses, attached a hidden camera to his ankle and ran a cable release up through his pants. He snapped this picture at the moment the execution began. In 1946, a traveling electric chair was used to execute Willie Francis in Louisiana. When the switch was thrown, the chair malfunctioned. The generator exploded. Willie was returned to his cell stunned and complaining of a taste of cold peanut butter. Appeals to spare Francis were filed but denied. A year later, the chair functioned as designed. Francis became the first and only man to be electrocuted twice. In 1953, convicted spies Julius and Ethel Rosenberg were sentenced to the chair. The Rosenbergs' executions proved once again the unpredictable nature of killing people with electricity.
It only took 2 jolts of electricity to kill Julius, but when it came to Ethel, they had to use 5 jolts of electricity to kill her, even though it was the same chair, the same electricity, everything else was the same.
At the peak of its popularity, 25 states used the chair as their main method of execution. By 1989, only 14 states still use the chair. Today, though infrequent, the use of the electric chair did survive into the 21st century. Alabama carried out the first electrocution of the new millennium on January 7th, 2000. Next, weapons of war become tools of execution. Florida's Old Sparky was constructed from lumber taken from the gallows it replaced. Death Devices will return on Modern Marvels. The firing squad is the most commonly used method of execution throughout the world. In the United States, 3 states currently have provisions for firing squad executions. The most recent was in 1996 in Utah, when a condemned man named John Taylor chose firing squad over lethal injection.
I'd just like to say for my family, for my friends, as the poem was written, remember me, but let me go.
There was a man being hanged in Delaware, a woman who was scheduled to die by execution to be executed in Illinois, and the firing squad in Utah, and all of the focus was on Utah.
For Taylor's execution, Utah designed a special chair made with its own bulletproof backstop. On the day of the execution, Taylor was strapped into the chair. Restraints held his hands, feet, and neck. A black hood was placed over his head. At 12:03 a.m., 20 feet from the firing partition, 5 marksmen, armed with .30-30 caliber rifles, fired at a white cloth target pinned over his heart. 4 minutes later, a doctor pronounced Taylor dead. Taylor was not the first person to die by firing squad in Utah. In 1977, a 10-year moratorium on capital punishment in the United States ended. The first execution of the new era took place in Utah. The condemned man's name was Gary Gilmore.
That no factual issues have been presented to the board which shows any reason for the board to disagree with the sentence as imposed by the district court.
He was given a choice between hanging and the firing squad. He chose firing squad. A simple office chair was used for the execution.
After the Gilmore execution, the media was all there sticking their fingers in the holes and taking pictures.
The exact origins of the firing squad protocol are unknown. But as the rifle replaced the sword on the battlefield, it also replaced it in military executions. In 1866, a Utah sheriff named John Gillespie oversaw an execution. A firing squad of 5 men was assembled and concealed inside a tent. Once the seated criminal was blindfolded, the sheriff sheriff opened the flaps of the tent and gave the order to fire. Traditionally, one rifle in the squad is loaded with a blank round. This prevents the members from knowing who fired the fatal shots. But like the headsman 100 years before him, the marksman proved to be the weak link in the process.
The accusation has been made several times that the firing squad either intentionally misses or intentionally maims. Elisio Mari's 1952 was one of those, where at the distance of about 15 feet, all of the firing squad missed. He was hit in the hip and in the shoulder and the arm. And so there's some debate going on about whether to reload or not, and he bled to death in the process.
In 1912, the state of Nevada attempted to remove the human element from the procedure by designing and building a firing squad machine. The enclosed structure came with its own steel backdrop. It was fitted with three pre-aimed rifles. The trigger mechanisms were controlled by three lengths of taut cord. Only one cord actually fired the machine. When the cords were cut, the rifles discharged. In the execution of Andriza Mirkovich in May of 1912, the machine functioned perfectly. However, firing squad executions were coming under increasing public attack. 9 years later, Nevada developed a completely new technology that was supposed to be quick and painless, with no outwardly visible side effects. This new method was called lethal gas.
The governor at the time, in 1921, was actually an opponent of capital punishment, Governor Boyle. And by supporting the development of a humane execution bill, he believed that he was helping to ensure that capital punishment would not be carried out in the state.
The next prisoner to be sentenced to die in Nevada was a man named G. John, who was convicted of murder. It was 1924. There was a new governor, and there was tremendous pressure to carry out the execution with the new gas technology.
Prison authorities hurriedly tried to prepare a means to carry out the execution. They found a barbershop, a stone barbershop, within the prison that seemed to be appropriate for the use of a gas chamber.
They sealed off one room to create an airtight chamber. From the adjoining room, liquid cyanide could be pumped through the wall by the use of a tire pump. Upon hitting the warm air, the cyanide transformed into the lethal gas. They tested the system successfully on two cats. On the morning of the execution, G. John was secured inside the makeshift chamber and strapped to a chair. It was a cold day, and they needed a temperature of 75 degrees for the procedure to work. They placed an electric heater inside the chamber to warm up the cyanide so that it would vaporize into a gas. Witnesses and officials watched through sealed windows. Though the execution took longer than expected, John finally collapsed and was declared dead. In 1929, Nevada built a new gas chamber using convict labor. At its peak, 11 states used lethal gas as their primary execution method. At the same time as the gas chamber was gaining acceptance in the United States, Nazi Germany was also experimenting with lethal gas as a way to perform mass murder. It is believed that following World War II, the stigma of the Nazi gas chambers kept lethal gas from ever being widely accepted as a death device in the United States. Lethal gas remains the most dangerous, expensive, and complex method of execution. Today, it is rarely used in the U.S., though in a few states, it remains an option. In 1999, Walter LeGrand, an Arizona man sentenced to death, chose that option. The staff of Arizona State Prison went into action, preparing for this complex and potentially dangerous event.
because it is a very risky execution in terms of the risk to the people who are performing the execution, it has to be done very carefully.
Sulfuric acid fills a small vat directly beneath the chair. A cyanide egg sits above the acid on a conical trap door. The final lever opens the trap, dropping the egg into the acid where it begins to vaporize.
And that's where they mix, and then it comes up through underneath the chair and consumes, envelops the inmate.
Arizona State Prison maintains many safety precautions throughout the operation.
You don't have a whole lot of time should an accident occur. You have approximately 7 seconds for the antidote to be injected into the heart to avoid a fatality. Right outside of the building, we have medical personnel standing by with syringes in the ready. They have the antidote in the syringe ready for injection should something occur.
Once the inmate is pronounced dead, the team removes the body. They neutralize the cyanide gas with ammonia. It is then pumped into the atmosphere through a towering exhaust stack. Once the chamber has been thoroughly cleansed, the execution is complete. Next, intravenous executions and beyond. Between 1930 and 1980, 945 men and 7 women were put to death in America's gas chambers. Death Devices will return on Modern Marvels. A lethal injection facility exudes the calm, clinical atmosphere of a hospital setting. Flanked by a special squad of officers called a tie-down team, the inmate is brought into the injection chamber and strapped face up on the gurney. His arms are spread out wide. An IV is inserted in each arm. Only one will be used for the actual injection. The second serves as a backup. The IV tubes run from the inmate's arms through a port in the wall to the chemical room, where the executioners are concealed by a one-way mirror. The Huntsville unit in Texas uses trained paramedics who volunteer to perform the lethal injection procedure. During each execution, they inject 3 chemicals into the IV tubing by hand. First, 5 grams of sodium pentothal render the prisoner unconscious. Second, 100 milligrams of a curare-like drug, pancuronium bromide, paralyze the muscles and stop all lung function. Finally, 50 to 100 milligrams of potassium chloride shut down the heart. Although most American doctors refuse to participate in executions because it violates the Hippocratic Oath, doctors are sometimes needed to pronounce the inmate dead.
Even though the cause of death is apparent, we would have to go through with an autopsy. But by having the physician do it, an autopsy is not required.
The concept of using chemical poison to execute convicted criminals goes back to the days of Socrates, who was convicted of sedition.
The senator said, you've got a choice. You can either leave Greece and admit you're wrong, or stay here and drink poison, drink hemlock. And he did have the dignity to administer his own poison and kill himself. But it was a form of execution because they had carried out a sentence, punished him, and condemned him.
During World War II, the Nazis performed lethal injections as part of their experiments with execution technology.
Germany also was beginning a program euphemistically called a euthanasia program, which resulted in the deaths of many people.
It wasn't until 1982 that the first lethal injection execution was performed as a method of capital punishment in the United States. Texas was the first in the nation to implement the procedure, with the execution of Charlie Brooks, a convicted murderer. Witnesses noted that Charlie Brooks wheezed and his stomach spasmed up and down as the drugs were administered. The execution was applauded as a success. In 1983, a lethal injection machine was developed. Two buttons were pushed simultaneously by two people to activate the flow of the drugs, one at a time, at an even pace. Only the computer would know which button had triggered the process. This information was erased during every execution. Today, most lethal injections are done manually to prevent back pressure from the vein from stopping the flow of the IV.
A machine is not sensitive to back pressure. By having somebody who is trained, such as an EMT person, they can feel that pressure on the syringe. So that's why we do that.
The system is still far from perfect. Problems can occur with the veins, such as having an IV fall out of the inmate's arm, sometimes spraying the chemicals all over the room.
We've had, on two occasions that I'm aware, what we call a blowout. That's where the IV has actually popped out of the arm. The most recent one occurred as we were just getting ready to do it, and the inmate looked over and said, "Hey, it came out."
For many years, the possibility of death row organ donation has been a topic of debate. But in most cases, it has proved impractical.
One of the truly sad things about lethal injection is that the chemicals used in the execution are so pervasive, are so powerful, that it literally ruins all the organs, literally cooks them.
One of the few execution methods that allows for organ donation is the firing squad. When Gary Gilmore was executed, he donated his organs.
Gary Gilmore's eyes were transplanted. There's a fellow living in Utah somewhere who has Gary Gilmore's eyes. There are certain parts of organs that can be used after firing squad executions.
Writer Stuart Creek has proposed a new method he calls nitrogen asphyxiation, which he claims would not damage organs.
When death penalty opponents began to sue, claiming that the death penalty was cruel and unusual punishment based on the way that it was administered, gas chamber, electric chair, that type of thing, it occurred to me that nitrogen asphyxiation was a completely painless way of administering death.
Nitrogen is odorless and tasteless. Since it is one of the components of our atmosphere, it is far less dangerous than poisonous gas. The victim would slip into unconsciousness, and death would follow, caused by oxygen deprivation. As more and more countries abolish the death penalty, there is also the notion that all of these death devices could eventually become relics of the past. The United States is currently the only major Western nation that still employs the death penalty. 38 states, the military, and the federal government all have capital punishment provisions. Each has its own laws about which method is used. It is the subject of much debate as the new millennium proceeds.